Hello and welcome to Learning Music with Pat. We've been talking about the complexity of instruments, how it's important when you put them together that you know what you're doing, not to jam them together and all of that. These instruments are complicated and you can injure them without even intending to. And so I'm going to show you an example of that. I brought back with me my soprano saxophone. And I'm going to show you a little wire on it, if I can get it right in position, and see how that works. See if I can get it in the position we had it in before. Like this way?
No,
the other way. This way?
No.
Ah, wait, we got it right here. All right. This is perfect. You can see there's a little wire on your top left. I'm not going to try to touch it. That's going to be a lot larger on the screen than it actually is in person. When I look at the instrument, it's really just maybe a half an inch, something like that, 3/4 of an inch. It's really not very big, but that wire is important. When I first got this instrument, I was going to play a solo on it, and I had been playing it, and it was doing fine. And when I went to do my solo, let me just take it off here so my arm doesn't break. I'll show you where it is. We aren't going to try to magnify it, but just to show you where it is, it's right here. You won't be able to see it, but it's right there. And I didn't measure it, but if I put my two fingers together, it's the length of the top of one finger to the bottom of the other finger, just using the fingertips. It's really very small. Well, I've been using the instrument, it was fine, and then I was supposed to do a solo on it, and I was sitting there before my solo, and I'd been practicing it, didn't want to play. And I had to really force the notes out. It didn't sound as good as it could, and I'm thinking something's wrong with it. What could be wrong with it? So just before I get up, I'm saying a little prayer. Please, God, show me what's wrong with it. And there it was. I looked, and that little tiny wire was out of position. It's supposed to hook up. It's supposed to hook up on a little indentation, which is, now let me take a look at it here. The indentation is right here. There's no way that he could pick this up on TV. The wire is right here. I'm sliding my finger up and down gently on it, and the indentation is right here toward the top of the instrument. And it was out of place. Just that little tiny wire was out of place. So what I did was I took a fingernail and I gently, and I do emphasize the word gently, eased it back so it hooked in where it was supposed to hook in. And thank you. Yeah, that's great. You can see it. I can see it. I can see it. I'll lift it up. Now you can see it. And the little wire is supposed to hook up in place. And it didn't want to do it. And I had to make it do it. I had to take my fingernail and ease it into place. And as soon as it was in place, the instrument was fine again. I had no trouble playing that solo. The whole instrument was not going to play because one little tiny wire was out of place. Think if it was something really major. You know, what if a rod had bent? We wouldn't be able to finger the notes. They are very, very complicated. And I brought this in to show you just so that you would get the idea of how important it is that you treat these instruments just right. So anyway, that I wanted to show you that. Now, I'm going to show you a group of pictures, actually sketches of photographs that I have of the various instruments, to review with you some of the things that we talked about the last time I was here, because I went over the fingering patterns and how the instruments finger somewhat alike and how you can transfer from one instrument to another instrument. So let me go ahead and start that. And then we'll show some pictures this morning. The recorder, this is the labium right here. This is called the window. This is the lip. This is the front joint, the top joint, the middle joint, and this is the foot joint, head joint, body, and foot joint. And if you look on the fingerings, you can see, and I'm going to show you with these with other instruments, This is C B A G F E D C. Just a straight line pattern. Most of the woodwinds are like that. So we'll go to the next one. This is more complicated because I have introduced more of the parts. This is a bore right here. This is the windway going all the way down, but it's basically the same. I've just added a few things, labium, lip, mouthpiece, and so forth. B-A-G-F-E-D, and then C. C is basically on the foot joint. Now, I think I'll skip this. Now, here is a conical instrument, a conical melody instrument. This is one that was produced in England. You can see that the window area is very small. You don't see the backside, but it's a wooden plugged fipple mouthpiece. But here's the fingering pattern, B-A-G-F-E-D. Now, it is in the key of D, it's not in the key of C, but since there's no tone hole in the back, if you use the same fingerings, it sounds the same as a C instrument. This is English made, and it's conical because it comes to a point. These are all my own instruments, by the way. This is a penny whistle, one of the smaller penny whistles. This one's in the key of G. It's the smallest one I have. You see the fipple mouthpiece, the labium right there, and it doesn't come to the point. So it's considered to be a cylindrical instrument. The cylindrical instruments do not come to the point, but the conical instruments do. And if you look at, this is also British made. It's a generation flute made in Great Britain. And if you look at the fingering patterns, B-A-G-F, E, D. It may sound a little different because it's going to be in a different key as what the C instruments are, and it's not in the key of D. I believe this one's in the key of G. And then here's a sweet tone, and the mouthpiece isn't too clear because it's black, but the labium is right here. It's a conical, of course, B, A, G, F, E-D. Notice that the size of the holes are not exactly the same. That's to accommodate the size of people's fingers, and it also works in terms of getting the pitch just right. In this one, I have put the conical and the cylindrical instruments together. This is a sweet tone again, and this is the G penny whistle. And as you can see, there's no side keys on them. One of the things that makes it possible for woodwinds to play so many notes is the fact there are so many side keys. And I did talk to you about that last time. Now, here's the flutophone. The flutophone, this is just my sketch of the flutophone. And the fingering pattern, B, A, G, F, E, D, and C. And even though the quality of the tone is going to be a little different, it's going to be the exact same fingering pattern as the recorder has, and it's going to be the exact same pitch. The quality will differ. There might be a different vibration, but it's basically the same thing. This is a thumb hole in the back, and this little thing right here is just a rest for you to put your thumb, a place for you to put your thumb. You know, it's just called a thumb rest. Some instruments have them, some instruments don't. And this is a photocopy that I took of the flutophone. Labium, mouthpiece, B-A-G-F-E-D-C. And you're going to notice that the tone holes are not the same size to accommodate the fingers and to get the pitch right. And that's going to be the same for all of these, almost all of these instruments. Now, here you have the Sassuto flute. I didn't bring one in. I did last time, but not this time. The penny whistle is a cylindrical penny whistle. Recorder, this is a tonette. This is a song flute. There's a little difference. This has a bell, this one does not, but they all are about the same. The flutophone, and this is a melody instrument, just a plain melody instrument that looks a little like a recorder, plays a little like a recorder, but notice all the fingering patterns, B-A-G-F-E-D. B-A-G-F-E-D. They're all the same. Now, being in a different key, they may not be able to pitch exactly the same, but the fingering patterns are alike. Even this, B-A-G-F-E-D-C. The flutophone here, I took that from an advertisement, and it's a little hard to see the tone hole, B-A-G-F-E-D-C. But that's the way it is. And here you can see the tone holes, B-A-G-F-E-D. So you can understand that transference does exist between the instruments, where you can learn one and apply it to other instruments. That's what transference is. Now, this is my piccolo. I do have it. I do have a piccolo along with my flutes. This is a Gemeinhart. And it's a beautiful instrument from Germany, very good instrument. Mouthpiece is traditional. They build it up a little around the side, the mouthpiece actually, you blow across it. You don't see the cap of it because they didn't have enough space to get it in. But if you look at the fingering patterns, I didn't mark them, but here's your B, A, G, F, E, D, it doesn't go below that because it's so small. It's about the third size of the flute, and it doesn't go with that low C. But at any rate, there it is, B-A-G-F-E-D. So that's my piccolo. Now for the flute, I did mark these out. The flute is a little bit more complicated if you look at it, because there are spaces, there are keys that you don't use and there are keys that you do use. It's the same with the saxophone. And so I've got them marked out. B and C is this. You skip this one. This is the A. This is the G, F, E, D, and then the C is going to be down here. But it's the same thing, the same fingering pattern as you have on the other instruments. This is the octave mechanism in the back of the flute. Now I have some a little larger here, and it doesn't have the whole thing on it, but it has what I want. Here's your B, A, this one is skipped, A, G, and then you skip these. I mean, those keys do go down, but they go down when you press other side keys. F, E, D, and then your C is going to be down here. Now, that's very close to the saxophone, because the saxophone, and I don't know if you remember this, well, I'll show it to you, because I've got one of the saxophones with me. When you do your fingerings, B, A, G, you don't touch this here. It goes down with other fingerings, but you don't put it down yourself. B, A, G, so you skip this. And then you skip a few, and you go down to F, E, D, and C. These here will go down as you press your side keys, but you don't press them directly. So the trick is to know which keys that you press and which keys that you leave alone that the instrument itself will take care of and press down at the proper time. So I just wanted you to see this. This one is a side key and it presses this. This will be your F sharp key. And for the octave mechanism, it's in the back, as it is with most of the instruments. And when I put my thumb rest on here and press this, it will open up the octave key, if I do it right. And the octave, I can see it's opening up, but you may not be able to see it. Where's the octave key? It's up here. You know, why are these instruments so complicated? You can't stretch every time you want an octave. Take your hand off position, stretch and press an octave key, you wouldn't be able to play the note. So what they do, they put rods in it, and when you press the key in the back, I don't know as you can see it, but it is opening up. Normally, you would have your hand like this, and you would press it. At any rate, when I press it, it doesn't open much, but that's the key that opens up. So you see these instruments are complicated, and these here that are not keys are thumb rest. Where do you put your thumb on your right hand if you're not going to be using it? Well, you hook it underneath that. That also helps to support the instrument. I have seen people drop instruments because they couldn't balance them right. And especially the recorders, because some of the notes you're using one note, or you're using one finger, and you're not using any more than one finger, and you actually can lose an instrument and let it drop. Well, your mouth helps to support it because the mouthpiece is in your mouth, but then you have to have a place to put the lower end of the instrument to have it supported right here. Thumb thing, and of course your left hand is on this little thumb rest here, which is the shape it is, so you can operate the octave key. So they're very, very, very complicated. But I like bringing them in, and I like playing them, and I do play them quite a bit. Saxophone is actually my main instrument. So B A G F E D C. And this one I think I'll skip because it's basically the same thing. I want to show you this flute. This flute is what's called an open-hold flute. And it's interesting because not all of the keys remain open, but there are little holes in the keys so that when you play them, the key itself, it has a hole in it, so it's open. These little dark areas, one is right here, right here, right here, right here, right here. So how do they get closed? How do you play it? How do you close it? Your fingers close it when you're playing it. When you're playing it, of course, your hand is on the key, pressing it down, and that automatically closes the holes. Now, the flute that I had in was closed hold. You wouldn't have to worry about leaking air anywhere because it's all closed. But some flutes have certain keys. They're very, very expensive, by the way. Mostly professionals use them. And the reason that the professionals use them is that these little holes and your hands closing it up rather than closing it up any other way helps to create a little different kind of sound. It's not hardly any different, but a professional will notice it. It's a softer, it's a nicer sound. They get just as closed whether they're covered or whether they're not covered because your fingers are going to cover them. But at the same time, it just gives a little difference in the quality of tone. Now, I had a student who had an instrument flute that could be both closed or open. There was like a little clip. You press the button and all of the clips went up, and that would keep the instrument as open hold. The ones that are open, not every one of them would be open. You press it again and it closes it, so you could play it as an open hold or a closed hold flute. Very interesting, extremely expensive. She had it specially made and she had to wait weeks for it to come, but it is a beautiful instrument. I've also seen that some people have gold flutes. It's just a veneer, you know, it's just a covering. I've tried to get one, but I can't seem to find a company that I can get one from. This is the proper way to hold the flute, left hand on top. That's the way with all wooden instruments. All woodwind instruments. That's what I was intending to say. Left hand always goes on top. Right hand always goes on the bottom. The fingers are always curved. You never play with flat fingers, and that's true of the recorders as well as all of the other woodwind instruments, because you can't play them right if you're flat-fingered. You have to curve them. So that's the correct position. Now, I'm going to skip this one because we've kind of done it. Let's get to the saxophone. This is what I showed you. Maybe a session or two ago, B-A-G-F-E-D. You're not touching these keys. You don't have to. Those keys open and shut by themselves when certain side keys, like these keys, or there are side keys on the other side that don't show up, and they will open and close as they are supposed to do it. This is the mouthpiece. This is the ligature of the mouthpiece that attaches the reed. This is considered to be the neck. Anytime you have an instrument where it kind of folds over, this is the neck piece. And then You have the body of the instrument, which is not, you don't pull it apart. You can take the neck piece off for cleaning. This is the octave mechanism, the same as the key that I showed you on the soprano. It would go up. This, you can see it more easily than what the instrument I brought in, but this is the key, the octave mechanism. And then this, of course, is the bell. It swings around, and this is the bell. And that this happens to be a tenor instrument because the altos, which are normally played, have that neck piece straight out. It doesn't take that dip. So this is a tenor instrument. Now another, this is an alto. You can see that the neck piece just kind of goes straight. There's no dip in it. And the fingering pattern, B, A, G, F, E, D, and C. Mouthpiece, ligature, octave mechanism. This is the neck. The neck pulls off, the body of the instrument swinging around and forming the bell. And you have side keys everywhere, so you can play an awful lot of music on them. So that's an alto saxophone. And I just drew a little thing for a saxophone just to review. Mouthpiece, neck piece, and in the back, the octave mechanism. This actually opens this here, which would be the octave mechanism, but you finger it from the back. B, A, G, F, E, and D, and your C is down here. It's on the bell, actually. The C is on the bell, close to the bell. This here, I put it in, that would be your G sharp key. B, A, G, G sharp, F, E, D, C. So I just wanted to do that little drawing in there. The clarinets, I guess I won't, well, I'll just go over the parts of the clarinet, but here is the ligature, the mouthpiece, the barrel, the upper body stopping right here, the lower body stopping right here, and the bell. We went over that before. So that gives you basically what I've been trying to show you, how similar these fingering patterns are, that you can transfer them from one instrument to another. Now I'm gonna close it off because we've gone, you know, we're just about out of time. And so we'll close it here, and please join me next time.